I'm right here.
Thank you.
So I wanted to say wood stoves are really good for old journals.
Good for what?
Your old journals, the wood stoves. Okay. Yeah. I went through that reading mine going, oh my God. Anyway, so the carpet cleaning man sort of brought my heart going, and I thought, you know, the reality of all of this is about, at least for me, it's about giving it away, right? So I look at the two of you and, you know, clearly singing is your gift that you are meant to be, I don't know if you're meant to, my feeling is this is what you're meant to be doing to heal the planet. And Sharon, what you teach, it's the same thing. And to you, the carpet cleaning man, it's sharing, you know, what that's your gift. Like that is really, if that's what you have, then use it. And I wanted to know if you bought the Mindful magazine.
I didn't. It's weird. I should have gone. I was going to go back and buy it.
Oh, she's in it.
I'm in it.
Oh, you're in it. Oh, there
selfishly.
You go.
Selfishly. But my story is...
Selfishly mindful.
Selfishly mindful. Sorry. No, but it was about my, you know, I created a nonprofit that brings mindfulness to kids.
Right.
But it was out of an anguished community where there was suicides and a murder and a couple of suicides in my daughter's class. So, but it's about giving away, you know, and I think that's the piece is, you know, I think about my journey to mindfulness, which actually came through Jon Kabat-Zinn, who I'm sure you guys both know. And, you know, it's from that. Like when you were talking yesterday about thinking of somebody, like, how did you get here? You know, and I thought, wow, you know, that's really... sort of how one of the ways I got here was, but it was through my own suffering that I found that. So I think it's just really about those lessons that come up again and again, you know, what can you then do to give it away? And so I thank you both.
Carpet cleaning man. Carpet cleaning man.
Hi, this is a message for Sharon. I was never able to sit still as a child or an adult, and you know, people have told me for years to meditate, and I couldn't sit long enough to meditate. So it's funny how sometimes you have an experience and then you read a book, and you're right in front of, you know, what you're reading. You just experience. So I read the book by Kornfeld, and he said that you cannot become a good meditator unless you know how to cry. Mm. And it took me years to sit still long enough, and eventually I could sit still, but I had to cry for days, and you know, now I'm a good meditator, and people actually admire that in me. So people ask me, how do you do it? And I'll say, well, you know, do you know how to cry? And there's some people that say, I don't think I cried since I was a baby. You know, and I want, does that apply to everyone or just some people?
I don't think it applies necessarily to everybody. but absolutely, I think Jack got that from his teacher, Ajahn Chah, who was a great Thai meditation master in the forest tradition of Thailand, who said something like that. I don't remember the exact quote, but... that's where Jack heard it. And, you know, I come back to what I was saying this morning about balance and how, in many ways, the goal of meditation is to move us toward greater and greater balance with the sense that out of that balance, the things we really want will emerge. And balance, of course, looks different all the time. It looks different between people, it looks different within ourselves at different times. So, you know, for some people who are out of balance in a certain way, it's not going to necessarily look the same for them the following year. You know, like I sometimes talk about in my early meditation where I was trying to sit and just be with the breath. One of the things I noticed was that almost as soon as this breath was beginning, I would kind of mentally be leaning forward to get ready for the next 50. And that was not just a mental posture I had sitting on a floor in India. That was very much the way I was. It was very frightened. I was very wary. I was very guarded. I don't know what might happen next. A lot had already happened to me in my life. And so for me, in those days, balance looked like settle back. Let the breath come to you. I used to say to myself, you're breathing anyway. All you need to do is feel it. Because I had so much performance anxiety, it's like I'd never done it before. So it was like, settle back. Let the breath come to you. And of course, there are times we can be way too far back. Like we couldn't care less about what the breath feels like, and we need to come forward and engage and connect and participate. So I see it sort of like that. For some people, for sure, there's something, you know, that will be very liberating to be with, and it will free up a lot of energy, and then you're able to sit. And for other people, it could be something different. It could just look very different, and so it's going to be a different process, but everybody's got something going on, you know, really. So I'm glad you did it. I'm glad you persevered.
Katie, a few years from now, your grandson Bodhi comes to you as a young man and announces he wants to go to India.
I'll lock him in a closet.
What advice do you give him?
Well, it really depends what's happening a few years from now. People ask me all the time, you know, they say they want to go to India. I said, why? Well, I want to find some place that they're chanting. I said, there's more chanting going on here. I don't think, unless a person is really drawn, really, really has to go to India, that it's any, it's that it will necessarily be what that person's looking for, you know. Like, when I went to India, that's it. I was going, and I wasn't coming back. There was no, that was the only thing in my, that I could see in my life, was to go there, so that's why. But unless it's something like that, I don't encourage it. Bodhi will probably want to go study tabla with some, you know, tabla master over there. So, India is an incredible place, but so is America, so is the rest of the world. I mean, teachings are available wherever you are. And a lot of times people get caught in the external trappings of the teachings and, you know, what it looks like and all the temples and the cultural aspect of it. And they lose what it's really supposed to be about. Like, you know, I was at a teacher training once and I was singing there. They asked me to come, and before I started to sing, they were giving a little talk, and one of them said, unless you know all about the gods and goddesses of India, you can never be a good yoga teacher. I almost puked. I was thinking, what kind of bullshit is this, you know? Why are you laying all this nonsense on people? They don't know how to get out of bed in the morning without tripping over themselves, and you're talking about shit that they'll never understand. What is that about? You know, so, I mean, I've lived in India my whole life for long periods and constantly going back, and I can't say that I even understand what it's all about there, even at this point, you know? So I don't recommend it. I just recommend being with wherever you are and doing the best you can. If you find yourself in India, do the same thing. I don't know, people say, do you know anybody to go visit? And I said, I don't really, you know? And there are many good teachers that I know of, but they travel all around the world all the time. People are always going to try to find something, you know? I don't understand that anymore, you know? So, unless you really know what you're going to, you know? Like, I knew I was going to see Maharaji. That's why I went. India was part of that, but to go be with him was why I was going. And so I think there's so many possibilities here. I mean, you know, in India, you got to worry about so many things. You know, what can you eat? What can you drink? How do you get places? You know, so many issues. Just survival. That there's a lot less time to actually spend dealing with your own stuff, in a way. So, is that what you mean, or?
Yeah.
When are you leaving? Been there, I know. So, I mean, it's an incredible place, really incredible. But it's also not like it was when I first went there, which was how long ago?
40 years ago.
Oh, Jesus. Yeah. Up then, you know, up in the where I went in the mountains, there's only one road that goes up into the hills. One road, one little two-lane road. So modern culture hadn't really got that far yet. Little bits of it, you know. So they still, the villages still got together and sang every, you know, once or twice a week. That was how they entertained themselves. Now they watch TV. Or, you know, watch YouTube. They got everything up there now. It's a completely different world now. There. But yet, India really is the home of Dharma. You know, that's really where it seemed to start this on this planet and spread in other directions from there. So it's an incredible place to go. But, you know, it's not required. Unless it is. Right? Only you know.
Like, what the mind is, what, like, we're meditating, we're controlling the mind. Like, who's controlling the mind? Like, where are the thoughts coming from?
You really want to know?
Yeah. I do.
Sharon's going to tell you.
Okay.
Well, I think I'll respond in kind of a classical fashion. First of all, I don't really see meditation as controlling the mind. Where reforming how we relate to thoughts or things like that, but I think the idea of control is a pretty sure path to suffering. You know, like the ways we blame ourselves sometimes for what we're thinking or what we're feeling. Like, I shouldn't have any thoughts. I've really decided I'm never going to get sleepy in meditation again. Or, all right, I've grieved long enough. It's done. I'm never going to feel afraid again. And then lo and behold, you know, it turns out we don't have control over what arises in our experience, over the content of our experience. Because every moment is said to be a confluence of conditions coming together and coming apart. So when the conditions are there for something to arise, it will arise. How we relate to it is another question. But that is a path I've certainly been down myself, and it really can be a lot of struggle that's needless. It's not based on reality. So, for example, I was sitting at my own center at the Insight Meditation Society one year, not long after we started it, so somewhere in the 70s, late 70s, I was sitting there, and we'd brought one of our teachers from India over, this man named Manindra, and he was teaching, and I was all upset about something that I was experiencing, kind of with the thought, you know, gee, I've been practicing for 5 years already, you know, why is it still here? And I said something like that to Manindra, and he replied, why are you so upset about this thought that has come up in your mind? Did you invite it? Did you say at 3:15, please, I'd like to be filled with self-hatred? Like, no. But we act as though we did, and as though we could have prevented the arising of something. And so that's the framework I associate with the word control. It may not be what you meant, but I'd like to reframe it, you know, away from that. You could say we're training the mind, or we're transforming how we're relating to different things that arise in the mind. So classically, the mind is knowing. It's consciousness. It's the capacity we have not just to know we're seeing a sight or hearing a sound or thinking a thought, but to as human beings, we have metacognition. We can kind of know about how we're knowing. You know, like I'm all freaked out about this, or I'm feeling very loving toward this person, or whatever it might be. One of the confusions we have is that in Asian languages, like Tibetan, Sanskrit, Pali, Chinese, the word for mind and the word for heart are exactly the same word. So it's the heart-mind. It's not just like a cerebral functioning. It's everything we know and feel, impressions and intuitions and imagery and thoughts. And, you know, so very often I've seen, like if you asked a Burmese teacher or a Tibetan teacher something about the mind, they'd point right here, like the center of the chest, the heart center. So very often I've seen people ask, Western people ask one of these teachers, like, well, I don't know how to bring, I don't know how to get out of my mind and into my heart. And they kind of, huh, that question makes no sense whatsoever. You know, it's like, I don't know how to get from a place to the identical place, which is, you know, from their framework, what we're asking. You know, so it's different. It's all kind of seen differently, but that's the mind. And what we're attempting to do is, first of all, to see it and to understand the nature of the mind. What changes, what doesn't seem to, what awareness in the sense of mindfulness is, how it changes how we are with something. All the flavors and the textures and the distinct natures of all the things that arise within the mind. You know, another thing Manindra, my teacher, same teacher, said to me once at IMS when, in that case, I was all upset because I was feeling all this anger. And you can sense a theme here. And he said to me, this is how you should be with your anger. Imagine, we have like a big front lawn in the center. He said, imagine a spaceship has landed on this front lawn and these Martians come out and they come up to you and they say, what is anger? He said, that's how you should be with your anger. Not it's right, it's wrong, it's reprehensible, I've got to get rid of it. I need a new therapist and how much money I've spent on therapy trying to get rid of this anger, it's still here. I've been practicing now for 40 years, it's still here. Or this is great, you know, I've got to like do this vengeful thing and that vengeful thing and finally destroy their life by doing this publicly and maybe I'll get it on Facebook and, you know, like, but like, what is anger? So we pivot away from the object, the story, the condition that is igniting the feeling as far as we can tell, and we pivot, like, what is this feeling? What is anger? What is it? And we don't spin off into a lot of analytical thinking about it necessarily, but we take a look. What does it feel like in my body? What's the nature of this? Look at that. Look at how isolating anger is. Look at how narrow it is. It's like if you think about the last time you were really angry at yourself, I don't know how long ago that was, but it's probably not also a time where you thought, you know, I said that really stupid thing this morning, but I also did 5 nice things. Unlikely. You know, mostly if we're really angry at ourselves about that really stupid thing, it's like that's all we've ever done, right? There's a kind of collapse. There's a fixation often in that. And so we, by looking, we understand, oh, look at that. That's kind of the nature of anger. It shuts down. It gets tunnel vision. Look at that. So, you know, we use the whole display of everything that arises in our experience as an opportunity to understand the nature of our lives.
Were you, you want to ask any more about that?
I'm a little more confused now.
Sorry.
About my question. Like, I know, like, I'm thinking, I know I'm having feelings, and I've been meditating a long time.
Yeah.
And I still have, like, I want more specific answers as to what the mind actually is. I'm not asking you to give them to me, but I would like to have them at some point in my life, and how it relates to consciousness, and how it relates to who is having the consciousness that is me.
Right. Well, that's the kind of question that usually is a very juicy question to do that pivot.
We'll do it.
Right? Yes. No, you're for you to do it.
You want me to do it.
Yeah, no, that's the point, is for you to do it. It's just like when my teacher said to me, what is anger? And that meant I had to stop obsessing about, you know, what that person said or what I said and what, you know, what I think should happen. And it's like, ooh, what is anger? Ask yourself that question. What is the mind? But not saying I've got to find out tonight, you know, or like, where is it, you know, in a kind of over-emphatic way. Use the question for the turn. What is it?
What were you meaning about control when you said the word control before?
Well, I was more like about who is not really control. That was not a very good word, but we have this mind and we're training it, or we're untraining it. We're learning things and unlearning things all the time. So like, what is the frickin' mind, you know?
Yeah, I think that's how you should frame the question in your meditation.
Yeah, that'd be good.
I think that's really good.
Okay.
Yeah.
Sit down and take a vow not to get up for 3 years. And focus on that question. What is the fucking mind? And then call me right away. I want you to call me first.
It may not take her 3 years.
Nah, but that she'll know. But, yeah. You know, they say that mind is awareness. You know, what we call mind in the West is really awareness. And through that awareness, thoughts, emotions, memories, stuff, they go through like birds through the sky. And they say that we get identified, we identify with these thoughts, and we think, I am thinking. But in fact, it's simply awareness glued to the bird, and it flies away with the awareness. And then the bird kind of disappears, and you're back. This happens when you chant, for instance, right? You're singing, and then you notice, I've been thinking about something that I left at home for the last 10 minutes. So you're back. So they say mind is that space in which these things fly through, enter into, which is, and that, so when you see it that way, then it's easy to kind of let go and be, and anything that you're thinking, even like, what is this? Eventually, you'll say, well, who's even asking the question? And then you'll find the answer, you know. Eventually, that essence will become aware. You'll become aware of that essential being, our true nature, awareness. That's what they say. She just didn't want to tell you that. She wants you to find it for yourself, which is probably better for you. But I wanted to give you some more to think about, that's all. When you're supposed to be meditating. Where are we?